Yeah, Monlam Festival is for everyone. Everyone, regardless of you are Buddhist or not Buddhist, everybody long for happiness, harmony, joy, in the personal life as well as the global, in the world, universe, contemporary world. So you are welcome to join us.
Hi, Khandro-la.
Hi, Joseph.
Hi, so good to see you again.
Nice to see you again, and thanks for inviting me again.
Oh, it's my pleasure. It's always good to have you to, you know, help me understand, you know, what's going on with Dakini's Whisper. It's always great to hear your words of wisdom.
Thank you.
It always brings me something to look forward to, you know?
We will see what's unfolds.
Yeah, so we're gathered here to talk about the upcoming events, and this is for the upcoming Monlam Prayer Festival. Am I saying that right, or how do you say that?
Yeah, Monlam Chenmo, and the Great Prayer Festival, English translation.
Mm-hmm. Right. We're brought here today to understand a little bit more about the Monlam Prayer Festival. And, you know, just learning a little bit about it myself, I understand it was, it says here it was established in 1409. So quite a long time ago, in Tibet by Lama Tsongkhapa. So, you know, this was way, way in the past. And from this historical perspective in the 1400s, how do we see the personal and global value of it in our time?
A good question. The Monlam Chenmo, or Great Prayer Festival, has a historical significance and relevance to our modern world. It is originally established to commemorate Shakyamuni Buddha's performance of miracles in Shravasti. It is also commonly known as the third of Lama Tsongkhapa's four great deeds, so great activities, so one of them. So Monlam Great Prayer Celebrations has been observed every year since. The purpose of this prayer is to pray for the long life of realized masters from all traditions, not only just four schools, all different traditions, Jonan school or Cho lineage and so forth. And so that's one thing, to pray for the long life of realized masters from all traditions, the growth of Dharma in the mind of all sentient beings, and world peace.
Wow.
So this kind of communal prayers with heartfelt devotions and faith help to overcome obstacle to peace and generate conducive conditions for everyone to live in harmony. I feel this is one of the most important and powerful events that Tibetan tradition offered to Western practitioners like us, so we can contribute to world peace and develop inner peace on our spiritual journey. You know, each of us has this deep longing, right? Deep longing for peace and happiness for all beings. And during this Monlam Festival, we get together to strengthen our aspirations. Mm-hmm. We offer our heartfelt prayers to bring happiness and harmony to the challenges we are all currently facing, both on a personal and global levels.
Wow.
How I feel.
That's very, very profound and sounds very powerful. And mm-hmm. I like how you said that, you know, basically what it sounds like is that, you know, whatever, no matter what time, whether it's in the 1400s or the 2000s, it sounds like it's applicable for any situation. Because, you know, no matter the century, we're going to face our own difficulties and things. So it sounds really nice that this is going to be happening.
Yeah, applicable, relevant. Actually, this is the opportunity for us to get together and really pray together.
And that's really nice because modern lifestyles, everyone's so busy, they don't spend some time to stop and think about how we can get together and, you know, help out the world. But I get the feeling that, you know, everyone has the sense of a sort of a duty to do something to help fix the sort of issues that are out there. And, you know, even maybe we can't fly to another country to help, you know, promote peace, but we can, you know, sit together in prayer. And I think this is going to be a good opportunity.
Yeah, exactly right. His Holiness called the universal responsibilities. Mm-hmm. Everybody wants happiness. Nobody wants suffering or pain. So for us, we have an opportunity to really help out this way.
That's great. And you mentioned that it is both, I think you said it is powerful and it is, I forget the other word you used, but I also know that this is described as rare. Participants during this festival will be blessed with the Machik Labdron Empowerment during the festival. And it is described as rare. So how would you describe the rareness about this empowerment? Yeah.
Each Chö Monlam festival, I try to do something special. So this year I decided to this Machik Labdron Empowerment, which has been very precious to me personally and to our community, Dakini's Whisper. As you know, Machik founded the unique tradition of Chö that has had a great impact on us on multiple levels. Machik is our source of inspiration and deep devotion on our spiritual journey. This will be an opportunity for us to make connections with her and her special teaching called Chö, or Chö in many levels. So especially in this challenging time, I felt it's important to make a connection with her teachings, her wisdom. So Machik Labdron Empowerment is one of the gifts I received from my teacher, the ninth Kekaje Tsundampa, during my 7-night wilderness Chö retreat. So this is part of the collected works of Podong Chöden Namgyel, the 15th century Tibetan great genius, I would say, and highly accomplished master and synthesizer of Dharma, I would say. Mm. He is a Tibetan equivalent to Thomas Aquinas or Leonardo da Vinci in Europe. So in this empowerment, Machik displayed her wrathful aspect, holding a siphon trumpet in her left hand and the damaru in her right hand, dripping blood from the freshly severed human head garland, dancing on the corpse. Her wrathful form of expressing fierce compassion is something we want to connect, we want to develop, we want to really nurture within us. Her sadhana, based on this empowerment, is a beautiful short practice, and I'd like to share commentary following it as a two-part series in March, so that we can incorporate this short practice of Machik, the connection to Machik, into our lives more and more in this challenging time, especially.
Well, it certainly sounds very unique, and I think that might be where the rareness comes from, as it has been described on the website. And yeah, that really does sound special. So I'm glad that you are offering this and that people get a chance to experience it. I also wanted to ask about the practices within the empowerment. So I see that it includes the transmission of Cho Tonglen, Machik's Guru Yoga, and the Seven PEs. Then there's also the group practice of Cho called Kakyaba. So you have many of these, you know, treasures up in your sleeves, and you sort of handpicked these ones. So I was wondering, with the different variety of practices, what would you like your students to gain overall in the Monlam Festival?
Mm-hmm. Traditionally, each Tibetan school holds its own Monlam annually, reciting together all the major practices of that specific lineages or school. So Cho Monlam started in Mongolia when the ninth Kekaje Tsundampa was enthroned there. So in the West, situations are a bit different. We want to be able to practice all the texts of the ear whisper lineage. I thought at least these relatively short, yet important, like a juice, important practices would be beneficial for modern day Cho practitioners to embody and integrate, actually integrate into their life journeys. So I'd love for those who participate in these transmissions and the practices to appreciate and treasure these practices and transmissions, because they have been carried carefully without interruptions by lineages, masters, yoginis and yogis. So I want them to carry into this modern contemporary world.
Mm-hmm. That's very exciting, especially when you say they're so juicy and they're sort of the richest parts of different practices. It's a really unique offering, and I think it just makes it really exciting. And you know, among the exciting opportunities that we have with the Monlam Festival, there's also it's called a public session of healing Cho. So what is that about?
Yeah, healing Cho for the public has been an offering that is very dear to me, very important to me. There are many levels and reasons for doing Cho practice, whether it's done for healing or for the highest spiritual attainment of enlightenment. So as you know, Cho is an ancient Buddhist ritual known for its power to alleviate physical, emotional, and mental illness. It helps eliminate obstacles to spiritual growth, and of course, ultimately cut through the root cause of all destructive emotions and the sufferings. Cho helps to restore the wholeness and peace in our personal lives and the world. So at this time, more than ever, I feel, Cho become a powerful, relevant method to bring the healing energy of peace, harmony, love, compassion, and courage to the world. Cho ritual also serves to assist the dead and the dying persons during their transition. So therefore, Cho healing for the public is very valuable. I invite people to submit names if they like.
Okay, so it sounds to me like the public session of healing Cho is specifically focused on healing. Would you say that the practices within it are
for everybody? Don't you think everybody needs the healing?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Regardlessly, I mean, especially those people who are really in tremendous suffering, but also mentally we are sick, in a sense, we need a healing power. Mm-hmm. So Cho has a special mechanism. I don't have a time to talk about that. Why Cho become a healing ritual? See, for example, for Machik, there's no enemy. Disease is invited, welcomed, then make it ally on their path. But anyways, Cho healing, just for relaxation, even take a moment to pause and lying on the floor. Actually, during the Cho healing, I invite people to lie on the floor, comfortable posture, and cover with blankets and so forth. So sometimes just letting go and the relaxation itself heals the struggle they are facing.
Oh, very good, very good. I'm loving the variety of things to do and things to experience during this festival in terms of different experiences in it. I also see that you've invited some special guests, Osel Rinpoche and Tukse Rinpoche, is that correct?
Yeah, so, and also Talo Turku. Anyway, Cho Muram is another opportunity, important opportunity and auspicious occasion to make connections with the lineage tradition, Right. We connected or contacted the Tukse Rinpoche, who is the eldest son of the ninth Jetsun Dampa. And Oseo Rinpoche, who is the official successor of Jetsun Dampa, two important figure in our tradition, we invited, but currently they are celebrating Losao in India, so I haven't heard back from them yet. We also invited Taro Tulku, honorary representative of His Holiness Dalai Lama, to Mongolia, Russia, and other countries. We hope they can visit us, or they can participate. At least they can send us the video of what we'd like them to speak about. Mm-hmm. I would love them to speak about the significance of the lineage and its connection to the ninth Jetsun Dampa.
Very cool. I hope they make an appearance as well. So yeah, I think that takes care of all the questions I had. I guess if I had to summarize, the Monlam Festival seems very exciting. It is unique in terms of where it came from, and it's also very profound and powerful based on the practices that it is offering. Well, that's just my intake on it. So I was curious to hear if you had anything to say about the Monlam Festival before we wrap up here.
Yeah, Monlam Festival is for everyone. Everyone, regardless of you are Buddhist or not Buddhist, everybody long for happiness, harmony, joy, and in the personal life, as well as the global, in the world, universe, contemporary world. So you are welcome to join us, although they need to sign up. Other than that, anybody can join. I'm glad that I had this opportunity to chit-chat with you about this important event. This is an annual event. Every year we try to host this event, but this year, this way, I was able to share a little bit about the significance of Chöymoran with you. So thank you for the opportunity.
Oh, it's absolutely my pleasure. It's always wonderful to hear your perspective on what is behind these offerings for the public. And it's always special to hear about the key points and why we do these things, because it's so important. So yeah, so thank you. Thank you for joining me and explaining these things. That's sort of it for me. I was curious if you had any, message, whether it's about the Monlam Festival or not, if you had anything to share before we close.
Yes, I'd like to end with, as you know, the Buddhist, it's always nice to put our, whatever time we spend in the context of this karmic cause and effect. So I'd like to end with the opening section of the beautiful prayers called the supplication to Machik Five Dakini, one of our lineage prayers, as our dedication of any goodness that come from today's conversations with you and our audience, your participation to the world peace and the personal fulfillment. Is that okay?
Yeah, I'd love to hear it. Yes, please.
So that we can kind of make a little connection. In Tibetan tradition, we call it tendel. It's a kind of a karmic imprint, a little bit, so that we make a connection to Machik and this tradition and this Dharma itself in general. Okay. So this is a supplication prayer done by Machik's eldest son, Gerwa Dondup, with heartfelt devotion and aspirations and the longing for the realization, asking mom, Machik Labdron, to give him a blessing. The same way we have this longing, deep longing, right? So asking for blessing. Namo Gurudeva Dakini Gerve Yamara Chate Ram. sema palo chimbe tenzima keru dengu ki gyu do ma je
Khandro-la.
Having me.
That was so wonderful. That put me at such a, you know, really eased me out. So thank you for that.
You have. Yeah. Yes. I hope you can join us, and also everybody who are listening, you're most welcome.
Thank you so much for joining me here today and talking about this. It's really wonderful.
Thank you, Joseph. See you soon.
See you soon. Bye-bye.